so we could get a view from the upper decks at night of Comet Kohoutek in the southern skies. It was very dim. It was much dimmer than our projections based on comet models had given us to indicate that it was going to actually be visible in the sky. It was much dimmer, and it was a big disappointment to a lot of people, particularly those living in cities where, you know, you can't see anything past the second magnitude star now. My question is, the reason after the fact that a bunch of comet specialists, including, you know, people at Harvard, the originator of the snowball model, proposed to explain Kohoutek's bizarre performance was that it was a first-time comet come out of the Oort cloud, and that when it got near the sun, there was all this polymerization of organic materials, which basically locked in the outgassing potential. The thing got covered with essentially sticky putty or silly putty or whatever organic. I think Sagan's name was Follens, which meant that the outgassing rate was dramatically diminished and the dust production, and that's why Kohoutek was much dimmer. Could that model, given that this object is, you know, come in for the first time, according to the JPL numbers, from the Oort cloud, could that model explain even a sizable nucleus intact that simply has stopped bubbling and outgassing and has been covered by some kind of tar so that we're not seeing the materials coming off that make it visible to an optical telescope?
Excuse me. Kohoutek is an example of the new comets, and we now have had a look at quite a few new comets coming in from the outer solar system, and we do find that they tend to be a little bit bright early on, and then their brightness doesn't evolve very rapidly. And the idea that we've got because of in the Oort cloud, they've got a lot of organics still in their outside from the outer solar system, and as ultraviolet light hits it, they polymerize, and you get these files like Titan file, and the volatiles are also because it's coming early. The structure's also largely intact in the older comets. They tend to have cracks which can release things. Now, so you'd expect the evolution of the comet to be slower than comets that come around more than once. But what we've seen here is not just the comet not brightening as much as we thought. We have seen the comet get dramatically dimmer. So at the time when this comet should be now about somewhere between magnitude 4 or 6, the comet is now around magnitude 11. Now, just to remind the listeners, for the magnitude scale, we go from the brightest is a low number to the dimmest is a high number, and every unit of magnitude means the comet is, or the object, is twice as dim. So a magnitude 5 comet is twice as dim as it's actually 2.3, something like that, as dim as a magnitude 4 comet, for example. So, assuming that it's one of these damped down, that's being damped down by having all this gunk on the outside of it, you'd expect it to be running somewhere between magnitude 6 to magnitude 8, perhaps. This isn't going down to magnitude 11 at the time of true brightness. So that's very, very unlikely. Because when we saw the initial dimming, we thought that perhaps some of the solar wind had blown away the coma and we were waiting for the coma to come back. It hasn't come back. It's also got dimmer.
Thank you for answering that question, Ian. Envy, Larry, do you have a question?
Hey, Francis. This is Nighthawk. You disappeared into the hole there. I think you turned down too much.
I did. I turned it down too much.
There we go.
Larry or Bob, do you have a question for Ian Musgrave?
Yeah, I do.
Go ahead. Shoot.
Yeah, my question is, you're down there in southern Australia and you work with that GRASS network, right?
Yep.
Okay, so when did the window for viewing Elenin, the comet, actually close as far as any of the telescopes just in Australia alone? When was the last real time that you could be able to view it from that area of the world?
roughly late August, early September, very early September. Francis, you were using Grass 09, I believe.
Yes.
Yes. The Grass telescopes can only go down to about 20 degrees above the horizon. Now, what you can do is you can, to see this faint comet at its best, you have to be taking images after astronomical twilight. But up until about September the 2nd, a little bit after that, you could just before astronomical twilight, you could still get some images, but they're going to be very badly degraded by the background. Now, you've got no hope whatsoever. And as Francis knows, the weather has been freaking awful. Unfortunately, the Grass Southern Scope is currently in Victoria, which probably has one of the worst weather records. So there are a number of amateur astronomers who are tearing their hair out over this.
Well, Ian, the reason why that question probably came out is that there are some people who are following Comet Elenin / a rogue planet dwarf star and saying that it was unviewable since way back in June. So, and they continue to say that. So the question was brought up just to confirm again that Comet Elenin has been viewable all the way up to the 2nd of September or so.
Yeah. So depending on how much light contamination you want in your images, and Francis, you managed to get some quite decent images despite quite a bit of twilight.
Francis, can I ask Ian another question?
Yes, Richard, go ahead.
Ian, do you know of any other amateurs who are doing what Francis is doing, taking narrowband imagery? Which, of course, if you do it even earlier than astronomical twilight, allows you to see, you know, the structure and geometry of the comet nucleus or the coma right around the nucleus, even in a fairly bright sky, given that the conditions are similar to a sky over, let's say, a shopping center or, you know, where narrowband filters really peers through.
Can you hold this on for a moment?
Yes, we're going to hold for a second. Richard, I think Ian had something right in the room that he had to take care of.
I've got small child out of the room. Okay. To my knowledge, from both the Ice and Space forums, the Comet ML forum, and my other friends in the Comet Observing area, no one's been using the narrowband filters very much. The big problem with the narrowband filters is even though they increase contrast, they also dim the comet. So you've got a trade-off between being able to see the comet against the bright sky, against dimming the comet, so you need more exposure time to get a decent image. And again, it also depends on the scale of the scope. Grass 09 is a really nice deep sky scope, but to get some really good cometary images, you would probably need something more like one of the more research grade scopes to get some decent stuff out. But unfortunately, not many amateurs have anything other than the occasional swarm filter.
Thank you, Ian.
Thank you.
Okay, I know that we have Kerry. How are you? This is Francis. Okay, Kerry's not there.
Hi, I'm sorry, I was muted. Hi, thank you very much for...
You're welcome. We're having this panel, and we're having each speaker speak for a few minutes, and then we're having the other panelists ask a question. Ian Musgrave, another astronomer from Australia, just gave us his update according to what he's been researching and seeing in images about Comet Elenin. Would you have a question pre-made for an astronomer like Ian?
Well, I've just joined, so I'm not sure what's been said. I don't want to have people
That's
go
fine.
Over things.
That's fine.
So
no.
Why don't I listen for a while, and then we'll go over some whatever.
All right, let me do a station ID real fast. Folks, you're listening to Revolution Radio here at freedomslips.com. Francis Walsh with Collision Course. He has Bob Andrews, Richard Hoagland, Kerry Cassidy, Ian Musgrove, and Envy Life. Envy, I don't know your actual name, but anyway, don't forget we're listener-supported, so, you know, follow the course here. We're trying to keep this rolling for you guys, and I'll turn it back to you, Francis. Thank you.
Okay. Hey, Bob, are you there? Energy?
Okay. To Bob.
Zoot, zoot. Hey, Envy, are you still there?
Yes, I'm here.
Okay. We've heard Ian speak. Do you have anything that you might want to ask him? Anything more before we go? We're going to go ahead and move on, I think.
Nope. He answered my question. Thanks.
I'm going to ask you, Ian, I'm going to ask you the final question, okay?
Okay, go ahead.
Alignments. Alignments with Earth, the Sun, and the comet. What do they mean to you?
They're very, very pretty for occasionally picking up some things with it at close, but apart from that, they are of no significance whatsoever.
Okay. Agree or not agree, the three objects were never in true alignment at the equators anyways, yes or no?
No, because Ellen is almost in Earth's plane, but it's about 1 degree below, so it's never quite aligned.
Okay. Thank you very much. Richard... Had you asked? Let me see. I think I have a question from the chat room. Will you take a question that I ask you from the chat room?
Sure.
Do you know Scott Owen's theory on the post-glacial rebound?
In general, large terms, yeah.
Do you think that could be assisting the Earth changes that we're all trying to find a reason for?
Not really. If people have been following our model, the hyperdimensional torsion field model, what we're saying, we've been saying it for years, having nothing to do with LNE, is that we're now approaching a time in the cyclic geology of this planet where there is more energy being dumped into the planet, in fact, into the entire solar system. I wrote a piece for Enterprise, and I discussed it with Art Bell the night that my friend Gene Mailoff was murdered back in 2004. I wrote it with David Brokop, where we laid out all kinds of amazing systemic solar system changes from the sun all the way out to Pluto, which have to do with this overall cyclic increase in energy that the solar system is manifesting. So the increased geological activity that we're seeing all over the planet is correlated very nicely with changes at Saturn. There's a new storm that appeared a few months ago, changes at Jupiter, the Io Jupiter interaction because of the sulfur Taurus, changes at Pluto. Pluto is going away from the sun. It should be getting colder, and its atmosphere is getting fluffier and more visible, and so Horizon spacecraft, when it gets there in a few years, is going to find some amazing things to look at, all of which is counterintuitive in a solar system where everything is mandated by cyclic changes on and in the sun. There, in fact, is a new solar model now which says that the sun itself is going to go through a minimum, like the Maunder minimum several hundred years ago, as opposed to a real maximum, which the fear tactics were being spread on the internet some months ago about major CMEs in 2012, losing the grid, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So in terms of the mainstream, they don't seem to understand what's driving the cycles of the solar system, and it looks like the HD torsion model is pretty much on track. So the earthquake activity we have seen, the bizarre uptick in very large earthquakes all over the planet, is not due to anything other than a natural cycle in the physics, which is coming to a peak sometime around the end of the Mayan calendar, sometime around 2012. At least that's the model.